The Catholic Channel, SiriusXM 129 presents Pathways of Learning. Here's your host, Sister Marie Pappas.
Today's guest is a world-renowned artist. Why then am I meeting him for the first time? I mean, how has he remained hidden from me? More importantly, how have I missed all his powerful, visually penetrating expressions of spiritual lives, human struggle, wounds, and transformative resurrection? Maybe I just wasn't ripe for knowing until right now. Maybe I was blind and biased by my preference for classical religious art. I'm not sure why it has taken me this long to become aware of Father William McNichols and his multiple works of art. Each one seems as though it is his one and only work. The faces are engaging and provocative. The details are purposeful and quizzically challenging. The beauty is mesmerizing so that one doesn't want to turn away, but so much is being said and it's so deep that a single viewing just isn't enough. My introduction to today's teacher of life lessons, Father Bill McNichols, happened as I watched the documentary film, The Boy Who Found Gold. Father Bill is that boy. The film artist who tells his story with and for Father Bill is Christopher Summa. Father Bill, welcome to Pathways of Learning.
Thank you, sister.
So listen, Father Bill, it's hard to know where to begin. I mean, your life story is woven with spiritual, political, ministerial, human justice issues, and artistic purpose. So tell us about your boyhood in one of Colorado's most politically prominent families.
Yeah, people always ask me, did anybody in your family go into politics? And I say, no, nobody but me. because, as I said, the church makes Washington, D.C. look like kindergarten, you know, so much. You know what we've been through in the church. And the incredible miracle is that it's untouched. I did that image of the bride, the church, and we could talk about that maybe later, but my image of the church is it cannot be touched, it cannot be hurt. The essence of the church is in that image, and I use the bride because she's moving, she's pregnant with new Christians, new Catholics, and she's moving from the beginning of time all the way to the end of time, to Christ, and he protects her. And that's the radiance around her is the protection, and there's little Fra Angelico, you know, hands coming out with knives and stuff, trying to get to her, but they can't touch her. So I can go into that later, but my grandfather was city auditor in Denver for 30 years. And when he and my grandmother were out one night campaigning, my dad and the rest of the kids, his grandmother was living with them, and she was a very tough person. She had run a boarding house for minors in Aspen, Colorado. And the Ku Klux Klan came because Colorado was the second Klan state in the Union, next to Alabama. The Ku Klux Klan came and burned a cross on the lawn because my grandfather was Catholic. And she took all the kids out on the balcony and she said, I want you to see these men. They're cowards. They won't show their faces. Don't ever be afraid of people that won't show their faces. And my dad told me that story the night of my ordination. And I thought, why is he telling me this now, you know? But then dad, as I mentioned before, was in World War II. He came back from that and became state representative, state senator, lieutenant governor, acting governor for a year when the governor was sick. And then the first Catholic ever elected in Colorado. And he was in the time of Eisenhower and then the time of Kennedy. So we had to move into the governor's mansion when I was 11. And I had to change schools from Christ the King to St. John's, and it was pretty amazing. I mean, the people that I got to meet, you know, the presidents, different people would come to the house, and I think I imbibed it. I think I imbibed politics a lot. And I learned the priest would come over, the archbishop would come over, you know. Well, the day after he lost, not a single call.
Oh my gosh.
No one. It was over. He was the loser. And not one person called except for a boy in my class, Peter Kenny. He came up and he said, "Billy, I just want you to know I'm still your friend." And
how beautiful is that? Very, very beautiful is that?
He was just a wonderful kid. So I learned a lot, and I still, you know, when I'm giving homilies at church, I always tell people, you know, Democrats and Republicans, those are clubs. They're like the Elks, they're like the Moose. They're not your religion, and they will drop you in a moment. And they are not safe to give your soul and your heart to. You know, it's like in Romeo and Juliet, when Juliet is on the balcony and she goes, "No, he's there," and she's saying to herself, "What is Montague?" That's his name.
Yes.
He's a Capulet. "What is it?" "It's just a name," she said. "So why do I have to hate him?" "Because that's his name." And then she said, "It's not a foot, it's not a hand. You know, what is Montague?" "Well, what is Democrat? What is Republican?" And I think right now, I say that all the time to people. I say, "It's not real. This is not real." You know? And you can make it into your religion, but it is very flimsy. It's very, you know, ethereal. It's going to vanish, and they're gonna dump you in the end if you lose. So people are not always excited to hear that. But I think they do listen a little bit to me because they know I've been through it.
And not only they've been through it. They see the fruit. We all see the fruits of the politics that put someone in office, and the lack of fruits that follow the person being put into office. So I think it's a shame that you have to point that out, because we should have learned it simply by experience. But good for you for pointing it out.
Well,
so that reminds me of one of your art pieces, Princess Diana. So you have this over 300 pieces of real beautiful, penetrating religious art. And I was very surprised myself to see that among them was Princess Diana. But I loved your commentary, and I wish you would share that commentary with our listeners today. Why Princess Diana?
Yeah, you happen to pick the one that's caused me the most trouble.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, it definitely, like I said, your work is provocative, beautiful and provocative. I'm like, what the heck is she doing in the midst of these saints and martyrs? But your answer was fantastic.
I'm not, I don't try to be provocative. You know what I mean? I don't, like, there are people who really want to make trouble, who really want to be out there, you know, being wild just to be wild. And I learned, because of the icon police, you know, I kind of learned that I have to say, I did an image of Princess Diana, I did an image of Rachel Carson, I did an image of Robert A. Johnson, but I did an icon of the Mother of God, similar to fire, or an icon of Saint Nestor of Ukraine. But I had to separate them.
I understand what you're saying.
But it still didn't work, because people still were just, you know, I heard the British Jesuits said, "Oh, God, what's he doing? She's like Madonna, you know. Princess Diana's like Madonna, you know." So that, the view of them about her. So I was, that summer that she died, I was in Albuquerque. I was actually doing work for Boston College, but I had to come back to Albuquerque to have lessons with my teacher, because the icons I was doing for Boston College were so demanding that I needed help. So I had paid attention to her a little. I watched that interview where she said, you know, there's three of us in this marriage. And I had I had liked her, but I wasn't, you know, like watching her all the time or a big fan or anything until she died. And for, you know, 3 days we were watching TV. And I saw what she had done. Well, I knew what she had done to visit AIDS patients, you know. And I knew also the landmine thing. And it just hit me, I have to do this image of her. You know, there's, she gave, the thing that I say most impressed me about her is that with her depression, and she suffered from a lot of depression. I mean, she was 19 when she got married. She didn't know anything. You know, and that she would force herself to get into the car and go to the hospitals and visit people. Force herself, and you know what that's like, you know, in ministry, when you don't feel good or you feel so bad, and the last thing you want to do is be in public. But she really pushed herself and would go out and visit little girls that were sick and give them lipstick and write them letters. And, you know, she changed the entire world. Her compassion, I mean, there's a new HBO movie on her called The Princess, and people never get enough of her. And it's because I think she rose above the politics of her own life and rose above the tragedies of her own life and really wanted to give. And that's the definition to me of a Christian, you know. I heard too that there was a chapel to Therese near Kensington Palace. And that she heard this story about, when I die, I'm going to drop roses, you know. And Princess Diana said almost exactly the same thing. You know, when I go, call on me, because I'll come to you wherever you are.
Wow.
And I use that quote, but...
I didn't know that, but the comment that struck me is that she was a powerful woman, she was in a position of power, and she used it to reach out to those in need. Those are not your exact words, but it was your exact message. And I said, I never saw her that way, but I looked at her in your
really?
Icon. Yes.
Oh, okay.
I never saw her, because she always seemed to me to be a very sensitive woman. You could see it in her face.
Oh, yeah.
But I never thought of her as a person of power, but certainly she was. She was in a position that gave her power. But because of who she was, she was about compassion. She couldn't be other than who she was, regardless of her position. So you helped me to see her in a very, very different way, as a model for those in power, how to use their power for good. So at the end of the film, and I'm sorry to jump to the end of the film, The Boy Who Found Gold, you give credit to the religious sisters who educated you. So comment on their way of merciful love that really, looking backwards, at least from my perspective, seeded the path of what has become your true purpose in life.
Oh, yeah.
Tell us about them.
Definitely. You know, women taught us in... I'm 73, but women, we had all women, and then Father would come in like once a week, you know, and say hello, and we'd all stand up, good morning, Father, you know, and then he would kind of say something, and then he'd be gone. So it was up to the sisters to teach us. And when I was in kindergarten, you know, I had this Sister Martha Ann, and then I remember all their names. I was in, we had a Latin choir, which we sang Ambrosian chant, and very beautiful. So I learned all the Latin hymns that are so, you know, I still love Adoro Te Devote, Andre Lingua. And as I mentioned, the Mass, also the Duraflé Mass and the Foray Mass. You know, Duraflé was the last Requiem done before Vatican II. So it's the last Requiem that was not written as a concert piece. But these sisters were named Sisters of the Precious Blood from Dayton, Ohio. So from age 5 on, I'm thinking blood is precious. It's not horrible. It's not macabre. You know, it's precious, and Jesus' blood is precious. That was the impression they gave me. And I concentrated on the blood of Christ from the age of 5, and I did a drawing, which is in the book, image to insight as a kindergartner that my mom kept of the cross.
I saw the image, yes.
Oh, you saw the image,
yes,
yeah.
Yes, I did.
And that was done, it was all their theology, kind of, plus mine, because I had those four little Book of Saints by Daniel Lord. Mm-hmm. And so anyway, those sisters really gave that to me without knowing it. And when I was in, we were confirmed at 10. So in my confirmation class, you know, sister said, "What name do you want to take?" And I said, "Pancratius." And she goes, "What?" "Oh, it's Pancratius." And he was 14 when he died. He's an early church martyr. And I was 10. So, you know, a 14-year-old's a teenager. I mean, that's a big deal. And she goes, no, you're not going to take Pancratius. You'll either take Anthony or Dominic. So I took Dominic. But I still wanted to take Pancratius. But as I mentioned, those child martyrs were very much my invisible friends, you know. And I mentioned the novel Fabiola by Cardinal Wiseman, which I read, and they became real to me. Agnes, Emerenciana, Sebastian. And of course I loved Philomena, because that was my mom's church when she was a child. And we were so disappointed when they bumped her off. And, you know, St. Christopher, I remember being in a cab in New York, and the guy asked me what I did, and I said, you know, I'm a chaplain for the AIDS hospice. And he goes, "Okay, let me ask you something." And I said, "What?" And he had a medal of St. Christopher. He goes, he wasn't Catholic. He said, "Every taxi cab driver has a medal of St. Christopher in their car." And he goes, "Why did they get rid of him? Now he's Mr. Christopher." And I said, no, you can still pray to him, because I did a children's book on him when I was an illustrator, you know. So it was really funny. Of all the people to take off, you know, the most popular, Philomena and Christopher, I mean, they were... So anyway, I, like many other people, just decided to stick with them anyway.
Oh, yeah. So a friend of mine just got a new car, and our local religious store gave her free of charge tab for the car of St. Christopher. Half of the Catholics don't even know Christopher is off the calendar. He's only off the calendar. He's not off the saint list. So... yeah, he still lives on. When you're popular, it doesn't matter who takes you on or off. You're popular, and that's what keeps you right where people need someone to be. So what drew you to the priesthood? So that piece of your story, I didn't know when it happened, how old you were, and why in particular the Jesuit community?
Well, I knew I was a priest at age five. And I knew that's who I was. And it scared me a lot, because I would look at them and I'd say, I can't be like that. You know, I'm never going to be like... this wonderful priest at Christ the King in Denver, Father Leiden, Monsignor Leiden. And I still pray to him every year, you know. But his personality, I think, you know, one of these people that was very... inside of himself, but he gave the best homilies in Denver, and they were only 15 minutes, and everybody would come. And he was extremely kind. I'd go to confession to him every week. I'd try to hide my voice, and he'd go, "Billy, how are you doing?" And I'd go, "Oh, no." And I followed him all over Denver after he left Christ the King. At every parish he went to, I just loved him. But we had totally different personalities, and I thought, you know, I can't be that. So I just knew that God was calling me, and I thought, well, he'll figure it out. You know, he'll figure out what to do with me. And I was a terrible student in grade school and in high school. I mean, I barely got into college, which is a really funny story I might tell, but I don't think we're going to have time. But anyway, I was in geometry class. My two brothers went to Regis High School in Denver, which is Jesuit. And this was during Father Jansen's was the general before Father Rupe. And we were in high school when Father Rupe was elected, and they were so happy. The Jesuits were so happy. So I was in geometry class, which I failed. I failed algebra, geometry, every single math class I failed. Because I
can't believe
it,
because there's so much drawing that's a part of geometry. I would think you would love geometry.
It's so true. It is so true. I'm, you know, but I can do it with my, you know, of course I use a ruler and I go, okay, three little things over from number one, you know. I don't even call them 16ths or whatever they are. But I was in geometry class and I heard in my spirit God saying, you must be a Jesuit. And I was so shocked I didn't get up from my seat when the bell rang. The new class came in and somebody goes, Billy, that's my seat, Billy. And I got up and I was dazed and I just walked around, went to the next class, and I thought, you know, okay. And Jesuits are so brilliant. I have to say, because I'm no longer officially a Jesuit, I get to brag about them all the time now. And it's really wonderful for me, because when I was in, I never could brag about, you know, I just felt embarrassed by that, you know, but now I can say anything I want about how great they are. And our freshman teacher, a scholastic, taught us to read Shakespeare. Freshman, we read Twelfth Night, and we read E.E. Cummings, and we read Vachel Lindsay, Emily Dickinson, and Jared Manley Hopkins, and we all understood it at 14. And then sophomore year, we had Romeo and Juliet. Junior year, we had Hamlet, and senior year, we had Macbeth. So the Jesuits were just great teachers, and I love that. It's just I couldn't do math at all. And in junior year, my teacher, who was a layman, Mr. Jones, and somebody came up to me at church and said, Mr. Jones visited church, he was looking for you, and he has a message for you. And I said, what? He said, do you remember what he told you? And I said, yes, I do. He told me, I will pass you if you promise you'll never take my class again.
Yeah, but this I don't understand. You yourself said that Jesuits are very well educated and intelligent men. They accepted you as a member of the community. So I have a feeling that you're exaggerating your difficulty with math. I've heard your commentaries, and you are very well educated. Even the research you do that informs the icons that you do, so you know so many discrete details of the persons that you picture, and also that you come to know, that you engage with as you pray your way through the painting. So I do think you're undermining yourself grossly.
No. After flashcards, third grade, I checked out. As soon as they started cutting up the numbers and fractions, I just could not get it. And part of that, which I don't think I should go into really, but I think maybe I need to say this, is that I had an incident of abuse when I was 5 years old. And I don't remember who it was. I just remember that after that, before that, I was a light boy. I was lit up like, you know. And after that, I became an introvert and didn't go outside much. And my inner life began. And I could not think abstract thoughts after that. So I couldn't do math unless it was flashcards, because I loved them, you know. So I have to be honest about what happened to me and why. You know, when you're abused, you leave your body, you know, and
I never
came back. You know, I'd be in class. I remember in first grade, sister said to me, where are your math papers? And I would stuff them in my desk. And she said, Billy, where are your math papers? And I was sitting on the floor and I pulled them out and was just weeping because I was so embarrassed because I couldn't do any of them, you know, but anything to do with God or art or English, I really loved.
Did your parents notice this dramatic change in you?
They didn't know what happened, though.
Yeah, no, I understand that.
Because I didn't tell anybody, because I didn't know what happened until
I don't think very young people, young children, I don't think they have words to explain that kind of violence.
No, you know, I didn't. When I was 20, I had an illumination of what happened, and I went, oh my God, you know, it's too graphic to go into, but I won't go into it. But then I knew, and then I realized that's what happened to me. I remember at the time I was sick for a week, and I couldn't get out of bed. And I was physically, I got a fever, I got very sick. And so anyway, I think that limited my, I wasn't here, you know, in grade school. I mean, I wasn't all present. And I stayed in a lot, in the house a lot, and developed a real strong inner life. Like Joni Mitchell talks about that when she got polio at 9. You know, and her mother came once that year, and her father never came. And so she developed a strong inner life from being alone. And I think I developed a strong inner life, a strong connection to the children who were martyred, which were abused children, like I mentioned, Tarsicius, you know, mm-hmm. who was killed during the Eucharist. And so anyway, I think that's part of the reason why I, my growth was stunted in some areas, you know.
Oh, I do hear what you're saying.
Okay.
After the sex abuse broke, and I began watching the hearings in the church and witnesses coming forth of how they were impacted. These were not children, although they may have been children when they experienced the violence. I sobbed in front of the television because yeah. I couldn't even imagine how it was possible to be healed of that kind of violence when you were so young.
Well, so it was kind not anybody from the church, and it had nothing to do with mm-hmm. the church. But
doesn't matter whether or not it was the
it
church.
It does. I know. Well, I mean, I probably never would have gone into the priesthood had it been anybody from the church.
Mm, you know? True. Very true. Yeah. Very true. So that kind of falls in, and I didn't anticipate this. There's nothing about it that I read as I prepared to share with you today that led me to know this detail, but your story is told in the documentary, The Boy Who Found Gold, features your early ministry at St. Vincent's, and you've already referenced that. So how is it that you entered into this ministry? Was it with the consciousness that you yourself had been violated? Was it assigned to you by your superiors, or did you request to minister to those who were afflicted with AIDS?
I was ordained in 1979 by Archbishop Casey in Denver. And I'm just going to tell this quickly, but I had asked Mary, please let me be ordained in May, because it never happens. You know, they always ordained in June. And I knew, somebody told me, if you put your priesthood under Mary, that you will last forever, that you will never leave. So the Archbishop, I was the only one ordained that year. It was a lean year, you know, and the Archbishop wrote to me and he said, you know, I can't do it in June. Can you do it May 25th, which is Padre Pio's birthday? Huh. And I was like, oh my God, thank you. Yes, 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 you know. So after that, I was helping out at the cathedral for a year, which I had been in eighth grade in the Latin choir at that cathedral, the Men and Boys Choir. And I got to see the church from the altar, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And
yes.
I spent much time as a little boy looking at the windows, because I was always, you know, figuring out what saint was there, what was their symbol. So that year, after I was ordained, Regis asked me to be artist in residence at Regis College. So I was trying to figure out my style. I was doing all these different things, and I did a chapel for them. And a Jesuit came up to me that year and he said, you know what? He goes, if you don't get a degree in art, you're not going to be taken seriously. So he said, you need to get a degree. And so I panicked, you know, and I could never take the SATs or whatever they are, you know, because I could never do math, ever. I mean, so I looked for a school that accepted you because of your work. And that was Pratt Institute in Brooklyn. Uh-huh. So I had to send in a carousel of slides. And then they would look at them and then accept you or not. And they did accept me. So I moved to New York in 1980 and was at St. Mark's in Sheepshead Bay for a whole summer, which was my first experience of New York, Sheepshead Bay. And then I went to Pratt and I wanted to be a children's illustrator. That was my goal in life. So I took anatomy so many times, they told me you can't take it anymore. You know, you've taken it 10 times. And I said, yeah, but I'm going to be an illustrator. I need to know the human body, you know. So anyway, during that time, I would take my portfolio all around New York because, you know, this was 1980. And I'd go to different, double day, different, you know, and they'd say, well, what books have you done? And I'd say, none. But if you give me a chance, they go, no, come back when you get a book. So never happened, you know. So Paulus Press had a contest and they called me and they said, you can enter the contest for the cathedral book by Maureen Gallagher. And I did a drawing of a child building a cathedral. And I won. It was the first thing I ever won in my entire life. And I was so happy. And after that, it went from book to book to book to book. I just had no trouble with them, you know.
How many times have I proclaimed that God writes straight with crooked lines? Over and over, the teacher of life lessons here on Pathways of Learning, all of them have illustrated this way of God writing straight with crooked lines. Today, we are just beginning to see how God has written straight with crooked lines in the life of Father William Hart McNichols. We're learning the wonder of divine and human self-expression today on Pathways of Learning, the Catholic Channel, Siriusxm 129. Don't make the mistake of thinking that when everything goes wrong, life's meaning and purpose has ended. It may well be that it is about to begin. So try to stretch yourself in your misery toward God, even when you barely know Him. Also, dare to put one foot in front of the other, even when it's dark. We're sharing with Father Bill Hart McNichols as we discuss Christopher Summa's documentary about Father Bill's story, The Boy Who Found Gold. So, homosexuality had been a closeted reality in the human community up until the crisis of AIDS. Am I right?
I would say Stonewall, you know, 1969. I was a second year novice at that time. When those people fought back and people were able to come out and be themselves at that time. But AIDS changed people's attitudes.
Yes, yes.
Doctors and nurses told me, they said, I have never seen such love.
Wow. You know,
these partners coming in every day. And they said, my wife wouldn't come to visit me every day if I were sick. Or my husband wouldn't come, or my family. But they were so impressed by the love. Wow. And they did that over and over again. They said, it's overwhelming to see how much love these people have for each other. And I already knew that, you know, of course, love is from God. You know, we all have love if we want to.
If we want to, yes.
Yeah, it's harder today, as we said in the very beginning. You know, it's harder today because we have the Montagues and Capulets going around shooting each other, you know. So anyway.
So how did this voice on behalf of the homosexual community become new and something more for you? Talk about your invitation to make your second novitiate and how it gave you a new silent but visually powerful voice. talk about what happened to you when your community called you to your second novitiate, and then from there, you found the voice of art.
Oh, you mean Tertianship?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, well, there's a lot of Jesuit language, you know?
Yes, there is. Very specialized language among the Jesuits.
You're a novice, then you're a scholastic, then you're a regent, which means you're a teacher. Then you're a theologian, then you're ordained, and after ordination, you're supposed to make Tertianship, which is, like you said, a kind of second novitiate, which you make, again, the 30-day retreat. And you also study the Constitutions, which is, you know, this huge book. And I don't think I remember a single thing. I mean, I had to read it, but it was like math again for me, you know?
Well, there's but been some wisdom since Vatican II, and constitutions need to be short so they can be remembered, so they can be lived.
I love St. Ignatius' spiritual diary. I have to throw that in. That's my favorite of all his writings. But anyway, so, you, at that time, you know, people were upset when I spoke out in Time magazine that gay people are not pedophiles and straight people are not pedophiles. Pedophiles are a different category, a different sexual category than being gay or being straight. And that's all I said, and it was a huge upset. But during the time of AIDS, no man, no religious man worked with people during my time that was not gay. Women did, but no man would even, because it was coming out. If you were working with AIDS, it was assumed by everybody that you were gay. So it was a form of being forced in a certain way. But also at that time, there was ACT UP. There were some really radical groups,
yes,
yep, in the gay community that would out you. You know, they wanted to out the mayor at that time. They wanted to out different people that they felt were really hypocritical. And I thought, you know, I want to be with the people that I'm serving. I don't want to be safe from the stuff that they're experiencing, safe from the violence, safe from the prejudice. And I could have been. I could have just not said anything, but I wanted them to feel that I knew what they were going through. And I was their age, you know, they were all 33, 34, 35. And I would take them to movies, you know, before that. I mean, I went to see the Alain Cavalier film of Thérèse, which won 6 French Oscars in 1986. I went to see that 8 times. I took different guys to see it. And the woman who plays Thérèse is exactly like her. You think you're with her. She's so good, Catherine Mouchet. And I remember sitting next to one of the guys that I had befriended. And when Thérèse has this drop of blood come out of her mouth, when she realizes she's got tuberculosis, you know, and then she takes her face and slaps her face, you know, and gets out of bed. And he turned to me crying. He said, I know exactly what she feels like. So they loved experiencing a saint who had gone through so much suffering. You know, they would not allow her to take any kind of morphine or anything, mm-hmm, at the time. And then I would take people to the Met to see Aloysius. There's a gigantic painting there by Guercino called The Vocation of Aloysius Gonzaga. And he became my patron. So we'd go visit him, you know, and I'd say to one of them, stand underneath him and I'll take your picture, you know. And Aloysius had his hand out. And one of the pictures I took, he's got his hand right over the guy's head. And I had been told that I would probably be apostolically unavailable. You know what that means?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. If I did come out, or if like I said, it was already out. And I thought, well, you know, I'm working with people with AIDS. I'm also an illustrator. I guess I don't really need to work in a high school or a college or a parish. And I've got this vocation. Mm-hmm. And then when I made tertianship, I was so excited for the 30-day retreat, because we had permission as novices to take that 30-day retreat both years. Normally you only did it once, but our novice master got permission from Father Rupe to have us do it twice. So I didn't remember the first one, but the second one was fabulous for me. So I was very excited to make that retreat. And I had choices where to go to tertianship, and I had two friends that were still sick, and I was afraid that they might die during that year. And so I could have gone to Australia, I could have gone to different places, but instead I went to Austin, Texas, to make tertianship, because I wanted to be close in case something happened to him. And the tertian master was Joe Tetlow, and he's another just wonderful man, a real Ignatian scholar, and a real warm kind of Southerner. You know, he called me Billy Hart all the time. And so we prayed five hours a day. And I went into it and I go, oh, this is going to be so wonderful. Well, it was dry for almost 28 out of the 30 days, dead dry. Every prayer was like reading a phone book. And even the infancy stories, which I love, nothing. So I'd go into him and he said, well, Ignatius has three reasons why you're not getting any. And he named all three. And I said, no, I'm sorry, it's none of those. And I go, but Julian of Norwich has four. And he goes, well, what's the fourth one? And I said, we don't know. And we both laughed. But he said, Billy, I can't figure this out at all. I don't know. And so I went back to prayer, and I went back to him. I said, well, I got something today. And he goes, what? And I said, the name Robert Lentz. And he goes, what does that mean to you? And I said, well, he's an iconographer that is doing 14 7-foot panels for the Santa Fe Cathedral. And he said, well, what does he mean to you? And I said, well, I've always wanted to be like the Italian Renaissance painters that had to be an apprentice. You know, Michelangelo, Leonardo, they all apprenticed to someone. And I said, Robert Lentz is the only master I know of. And right away he said, you're going to call him right after retreat.
Wow.
That's it. So I ended up calling him after retreat, and he had seen the painting I did called The Epiphany about AIDS in a magazine, in Catholic magazine. He said, you know, I wrote you a letter, but you never answered me, so I thought you were kind of a snob. And I said, Robert, I never got that letter. And he said, what I wrote you is, I think you're trying to do icons, and I think you should come and study with me. So I ended up moving to Albuquerque.
Yeah, and so what, here you were in this space of darkness, of dryness, and life began, not just for you, but for all of us, because your gift has become our grace and our gift. Our guest today, our teacher of life lessons, is Father William Hart McNichols. He has at least 300 art pieces on display in churches, museums, Vatican schools, homes, and other institutions. Today we are learning to speak truth with a voice that can be seen. It's today's lesson from a spiritual artist on Pathways of Learning, the Catholic Channel, Siriusxm 129.
Sometimes everything is wrong.
When your voice is silenced, not received, find a place of solitude. Reflect, pray, encounter, and explore a new way to communicate, to shout and be heard. One with a beauty so compelling, a truth so true, that many will listen and long for more and more. Father William Hart McNichols is sharing his own newfounded voice. So, Father Bill, I deliberately included your middle name to offer the fullness of our our identity gets lost, but your storyteller, Christopher Summa, makes a point of telling the story of your middle name, Hart. He does this through your narration and also through the powerfully beautiful image of the deer in the forest that he uses throughout the film. So talk about the significance of your middle name and how you have incorporated this image into your art pieces, even though your art pieces remain unsigned.
Yeah, you can't sign. I signed landscapes when I did them, and I signed drawings when I did them. But you're not supposed to sign an icon because the Holy Spirit did.
That does it. That's exactly right. It's the work of God.
So I didn't. So I don't sign them. When I was born, this was a very strange thing. You know, my mother's mother, meaning my mom's name was Hart, and her father was from Brooklyn. Isn't that wild?
It is.
Robert Hart, yeah. So he moved to Denver, and his fiance was named Mimi O'Hare. And so anyway, when I was born, she said this thing to Mom that was kind of shocking for me to hear as a child, and I'm not sure it was exactly the right time to tell me this because it kind of haunted me. But she said, you know, when you were born, my mother took you in her arms, and she said, don't get too close to this one. He belongs to God. And when I heard that as a child, it was like I was already, you know, going inside myself because of what had happened to me. But also I didn't know what that meant. Could I have friends? Could I, you know, I mean, everything was kind of a little bit thrown off. And then my other grandmother said, he's going to be the tallest boy. And I turned out, yes, I turned out to be 6'1". My dad was six feet. But anyway, Mom's mother died a year after I was born. And, but she called up Mom. My grandfather was named William Henry McNichols. My uncle, who was mayor, was William Henry McNichols. And Mom was going to name me William Peter. I don't know why. And it was in the newspaper and everything. And then her mother called up and she said, honey, you have to name him for our family. You have to name him Hart. And so I got the name. And then later on, as a Jesuit, I learned that the name Hart was the old English medieval name for a deer. As the heart longs for running streams, so longs my soul for you, my God. And immediately I connected. I used that deer as kind of my totem. And when I was working with people with AIDS, I had a logo that had a deer with an arrow in it, and I got that from John of the Cross. The wounded heart, or the wounded deer, has been wounded by God. And a wound that never heals because you're longing for God. And that has sort of been my life, you know, longing for God. I feel like a baby bird, you know, I have to wake up every morning and be fed, you know, or else I'm not going to make it. And that's sort of the Franciscan part of me that I love Francis for. His poverty was not necessarily only about things, but it was about you have to ask God every day. And so you end up deeper because you're always asking, can I have lunch, God, you know, would you bring me lunch, or I need some money, or I need this, or, you know, I need to go visit someone like Princess Diana, and I am not in a space to go out of the house. So you're asking God for everything, and I really love that. I became a Third Order St. Francis, of St. Francis. So anyway, that's how I got the name Hart, and then... the first time I used it was on these cards we made when we were in high school. You had to make a card with your name. And I used my full name, William Hart McNichols. And I thought, that's actually kind of a great artist name, you know? If you have Thomas Hart.
I like the play on Hart and Hart. So Father Michael Hart, first you gave tribute to him. Michael Judge. I'm sorry, yeah. Michael Judge. You gave tribute to him. Just as a man and as a priest, long before his great courageous act on behalf of those who suffered in 9/11, who were killed, and how I still see the image of him climbing the rubble in search of those who had died. And you have him in the heavens.
Yeah.
There's this white veil, I think of it as a cloth. And then you follow that in your commentary in the documentary with another art piece. And there you have that same white veil. And it's in memory of all those who have been victims of sexual violence. And it just, yeah. And I didn't know your personal story until today when we've shared, but I have to say that it, even when the sex abuse crisis came out, and as a teacher of young students, to try to imagine what it was like for them, and the same as you gave witness to, so many young children who had been violated went into themselves, but in ways that they didn't have the language of art to help them process and heal pain, as you have. You have been an artist from birth, probably. And so their twists and turns within themselves were less graceful. Even though yours has been painful, you have a language with which to handle it. And so many have not, who were violated. And in the two icons, I saw the depth of your compassion, your the purity of that white cloth, especially yeah. in regard to those who had been so violated, just seemed something very, very, very powerful to me. And Father McNichols, I'm sorry to say that our hour has come to an end, and I know there's so much more. I can only ask our listeners to explore you, to try to watch the documentary. It is on YouTube. You can see the whole thing. And I just pray that you continue to do what you have done, what you are doing. You are certainly God's great gift, great artist for our hearts in the season of our lives. And I thank God that we are blessed that in your life, God has written straight with crooked lines. Thank you so much for being with us today.
Thank you, sister.